Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We've got our top eight for the evening, which we already, you know, Sperling just, you know, mea culpa that he spoiled it earlier. We're doing the top eight standard sideboard cards for GP Houston. So standard's in kind of a funny spot. We were talking about this in the Magic TV chat, that a lot of these cards are cards that you see in main decks. They're not like main deck staples, but every one of these cards almost, I think, maybe except for the very first one that we're going to talk about, sees play in some main deck somewhere at some time.
I think that's right.
Yeah.
And I think I think that speaks to a theme about this list, that these are utility cards, not hate cards for the most part.
Which is kind of how Magic is gone these days.
You're not going to see Choke on this list. You're not even going to see Leyline of the Void, because the card, even a card like that isn't, we haven't seen that in a few sets.
Right.
Cards like that.
Yeah, all you have now is like a Cranial Archive for Rally or whatever. That's the only
you know, the choke that they'll print now is called Self-Inflicted Wound.
Exactly.
The Leyline of the Void is called Cranial Archive, and so these are like much more toned down versions, just much more subdued.
So they don't swing a matchup on their own like they used to. So
it's not, I drew it, yay, like this game's going to be simple.
These are all, every card on this list is a card that's kind of just going to give you a little advantage in the game, just a little edge.
So sideboarding is almost more about adjusting the composition of your deck as opposed to
getting
posing
lucky and drawing
specific
the card.
Archetypes.
Yeah.
It's more about getting the right specific tools than...
You think is fun, I guess.
Yeah.
I'd rather just draw Stony Silence and win the game, but that's just me.
Modern might be the format for you.
Yeah,
this is standard we're talking about.
Well, I do love colorless cards, so I think that's the way to go. We're going to start with number eight, and that's Irration Cleric. Now, I think a while ago, this would have been pretty low on the list for this card. This is one of the most impactful sideboard cards against an archetype. When we talked about that there's no real hosers, I think this is probably the closest that you get on this list to like a pure hoser. And I mean, that's kind of a silly thing to say about a 2-mana 1/3, but it's kind of got the perfect stats, right? It's cheap, gains you 3 life, and it's got that body that blocks 1 toughness creatures, of which there are many because there are tokens. You know, the classic 2/1, this is a pure wall against that card.
Oh, yeah, but it's a wall, but not... It's more than a wall, because the one power it has is really important. When you're blocking three or five tokens, the fact that one of them is going away is really important. Irration Cleric is... It's not number two on this list, because A, it's very narrow, and B, it's a narrow card that it's just not that powerful a Magic card. It's not Circle of Protection red. It is just a 1/3 in some sense.
Yeah.
That's a really good point. I actually think it's a less powerful card than Surge, but Surge didn't make the cut. Spoilers. Because because Irration Cleric is seeing so much more play right now. It's just seeing a ton of play in a ton of different sideboards. And the main purpose for that is because when you're sideboarding in these collected company decks, you still want to keep your number of hits high. And because Rally and Bant Aggro are two of the top tier decks right now, Irration Cleric is seeing a ton of play because it's a card that you can board in. And even though I don't think Red Aggro is particularly good right now, it's still worth having this card in your sideboard because it's a hoser that you can hit with Collected Company.
Yeah, this absolutely right. Ojutai's Command and Collected Company have propped this card up. And kind of, I would say those two 4-mana spells that interact with this 2-mana spell have kind of put it on the list.
Yeah, and... I'd say the reason that it's at 8 instead of higher is that, yeah, Tarka Red just isn't the kind of deck that you really need to stop as much anymore as it used to be. But, number 7, we've got Duress. Duress, classic sideboard card. This is a card that's crept its way into some main decks even.
It's playable in every format that's legal in, I think. I mean, so it definitely passes that raw power level test. It's got the right mana cost. It's 1. And then that makes it really easy to trade up whenever you're confident that you can trade with, that you can use it to trade. What I mean by that is that with any discard spell like this, like the goal is that I'm investing some mana and I don't even get to spend my opponent's mana. It's not a counter spell, but I get to kind of knock something out. So it gets better when people are relying on one particular card to win.
Right.
Rally the Ancestors, that props this card up.
Yeah, it trades up in like for the uniquely powerful spells. If if you're just grabbing a removal spell from a deck with a lot of removal, then that's when it's not as good. You know, when you look at a hand of four removal spells and you take one, you haven't actually done anything.
That's right.
But when you look at a hand of three removal spells and a Gideon, and you take a Gideon, then that makes all the difference.
Or, and critically in this format, my draws with Collected Company in them are just very different than my draws without Collected Company. My hands with Rally the Ancestors in the mid game are very, the game plays out very differently than the games where I don't have a Rally the Ancestors in the mid or late game, right? So the fact that those high impact spells exist, that makes it a climate where you can sideboard in duress and feel good about it.
The archetype that I've liked Duress the most in is the one that I've been championing this entire cast, and that's Mardu Green, because for starters, like, your lands are really wonky when they're first coming into play. In the first few turns of the game, you're playing so many comes into play tapped lands, so slipping a Duress in there, get a little bit of disruption going on for just a single mana, very key, very good. The other big thing is, if your Duress bricks, it's not a big deal. You're playing all these Read the Bones and, like, Goblin Dark Dwellers, Flashback Read the Bones and whatnot. So just the fact that it's efficient is really a big, big game. And then the downside for bricking is not as high as it is with most decks, where, like, the loss of a card would be a much bigger deal. And then finally, I have one more reason.
I have another reason. It's almost always accompanied by Murderous Cut or Dig Through Time or both. When you look at these deck lists, that's automatically going to make you more interested in a Duress. It's going to make your removal spell actually castable in the early game even, and it's going to make your Dig Through Time, again, castable in the earlier portion of the game.
Yeah.
That adds value to Duress automatically, and you just you're usually going to see it with either Murderous Cut or Dig Through Time.
And that's importantly, unlike Negate, Duress lets you pay your mana up front. So when you're playing a deck like Mardu Green and you need to curve out in some way, you go tap land and then an untapped land. Now you've got a window for Duress that you can go 3-drop, 4-drop, 5-drop. And you know that the coast is clear all the way up and you don't have to leave mana up. I mean, obviously in Mardu Green you don't have blue mana, but...
There's some of the cards we're going to talk about on this list require you to leave mana up. And they're not even all blue cards necessarily. I mean, well, maybe... We'll talk about that later, but I do think that the fact that you can just spend the Duress turn one, put it in your graveyard, see what the opponent has, there's a lot of value there. That's why it's playable in every format.
Yeah, and the information
and
one of
the big things about Duress in the current format is that information is so valuable. Knowing whether your opponent has a Reflector Mage might change which creature you're playing. Knowing whether your opponent has a backup Rally the Ancestors or a Collected Company, like, that might change your entire turn. Like, you might not make a lethal attack because your opponent's got a Collected Company in their hand.
Oh yeah, there's actually different kinds of morphs in competitive decks. That's something that's been kind of rare over the history of the morph ability. In this case, Megamorph. But in the history of that ability, it's been kind of a running joke in Constructed. Oh, I wonder what that morph is, because most decks only play one. But actually, you play against Bant Company, you get people.
Right.
One copy of Hidden Dragon Slayer in some lists, one copy of Stratus Dancer,
Stratus
two
Dancer
copies of Stratus
one,
Dancer.
Yeah.
Not to mention that
because they're going to think it's Deathmist Raptor or Den Protector.
Exactly.
Yeah. All right, well, that's our number 7. Number 6... is Roast. So this card kind of bridges that really important gap for red spells, which is that usually when you add the fourth toughness to your creature, you're safe. You're safe from a red deck. And Roast critically gave red decks access to a card that can kill Siege Rhino or Anafenza.
No, and it not only does that, but it does it at an efficient price at... I mean, it's almost a historic anomaly that you would be able to kill a 4-5 creature for red and one. And you have to think, is this might be the case because, you know, Siege Rhino, okay, we're going to print this, like, we're going to really aggressively cost this Siege Rhino card. We're going to need to surround that with some answers that we might not print at the cost to print at. What does that boil down to? It boils down to a cheap way to kill Anafenza, the foremost,
yep.
Goblin Dark Dwellers, Siege Rhino,
Kalidus.
And I think Kalidus, and to do it at a price where you're not embarrassed to kill their Jace with it.
Right.
It's not, like, I think, so I would draw a line in the sand at maybe Ruinous Path at one black,
right.
Sorcery speed. It does feel a little bit icky to spend your whole turn like that. But in a red deck, this Roast might not be your whole turn, and if it gets in underneath the first Jace activation,
yep.
that stuff matters because decks are playing Jace alongside Siege Rhino. They're actually playing Jace alongside Anafenza. So you might actually
alongside Siege Rhino, yep. what a world we live in.
Absolutely. So the climate is right for Roast in a number of different ways.
The Jace comment is so stellar. That's such a great point. And as I mentioned earlier, the mana bases in this format, lots of comes into play tap lands. The efficiency of your removal suite matters ton. And Roast is just so efficient. And it's so important. A lot of the times I find myself main decking a Roast and then sideboarding another copy or two, just because it's so good against the decks where it has multiple targets. One other interaction with Roast that's kind of interesting is that a lot of the Mardu type decks are playing Soulfire Grandmaster, and so it's an efficient card that you might have a chance of rebuying, and then also the five point life swing.
Yeah,
pretty huge in a racing situation.
Oh yeah, no, that's a good point that I didn't think about. But yeah, you put this in your Soulfire Grandmaster deck, and all of a sudden, roasting a token doesn't even feel bad if it's a lightning helix.
Life is important.
If it's a five point lightning helix, you don't care what you're roasting. That's an interaction to keep your eye on. If you think about, I'm playing Soulfire Grandmaster already, I might want to shore up my Siege Rhino matchup a little bit. Maybe this is a card that you should be looking at.
Well, that's our number six on the list. At number five, we've got Kalidus, Traitor of Ghent.
Splashy card.
This is the most exciting card that we've had on the list so far.
A card that jumped off the spoiler to a lot of people, saying this is an aggressively costed card. It does a lot. Lifelink. Turns off death triggers. No, mm-hmm. You know, whether that matters or not depends on the format. Well, how many times have we mentioned Rally already?
In this format, that's probably the most important part, right?
Yeah. So, I mean, Caleb, what do you think about this particular card?
Kalidus, I like a lot. It's a ton of fun, and it's very powerful and swingy without being overpowered. I've seen Grixis controlled lists main decking three copies, and it's as their main like finisher alongside Chandra. It's a way to gain advantage in the grindy matchups because you can play a Murderous Cut the same turn. All of a sudden you have a 2/2, you have two bodies, very difficult for the opponent to deal with profitably. I think it's an interesting sideboard card because the Rally decks in particular are main decking a ton of bounce. They're playing a ton of creatures that bounce your stuff.
Sidisi's Faithful and Reflector Mage.
Sidisi's Faithful, Reflector Mage. Usually they don't board out the Reflector Mages. They do board out the Sidisi's Faithful. Mm-hmm. So the permanent-based graveyard hosers actually get a lot better post-board in the deck in the matchups that you really want them.
Yeah, this is a card that's got something kind of for everyone, right? It's got Lifelink, and it's a 3/4 that's good against aggro, and then it's got this ability that's good against Rally in mid-range decks that rely on the graveyard, and then it's got this kind of like long game ability to make zombies. So it's got every angle covered. You know, it's just one of those complete cards that you're never unhappy with it.
It is a little slow in some matchups. It's a little bit slow against ramp. It's not very good at applying pressure, and when your opponent has a lot of ways of killing it, when you tap out for it on turn four, they're going to kill it, and you're not going to get any value. Whereas the price in this format for a 4-drop is you play it, you get like a ton of value, and it's awesome whether they kill it or not. So
yeah.
that's a consideration.
Yeah, that's right. And I think that's the other consideration in my mind is the competition. Creatures that cost 4 or 5, right now you can actually you can just get a lot.
Yeah.
For 4 or 5 mana. You can get a lot for 3. Yeah. Anafenza, for example, and Mantis Rider. I mean, there's cards that give you a lot of on the board impact and even protection against graveyard if you're talking about Anafenza.
Yep.
So there's just competition. That's why I think maybe that pushes this into the sideboard sometimes. I think the fact that all this main deck bounce might push this card into the sideboard. So if you're wondering why it's on the sideboard list, we've already mentioned it. It's really because you just don't know when this card's going to match up poorly. And the fact is you don't always want a 4-mana creature in a lot of these game one matchups.
Well, that's our number 5, and it kind of explains why this card is one spot higher. We've got Anafenza the Foremost at number 4. So you shave a mana off the cost, get that same graveyard nullification effect, and you've got a real winner.
Standard right now is kind of all about the assumption that a card that costs 2 different kinds of mana or 3 different kinds of mana should be hard to cast. Or,
right.
I mean, but the mana in Standard is really good. Casting a 3-mana spell on turn 3, you know, in traditional Magic terms, you might have thought about having to wait a turn or two to even get this into play. With these mana bases in this Standard, you've got enemy man lands helping to power this card out, and you've got all these, of course, battle lands and fetch, you know, 10 fetch lands in your deck, or even more if you're Ben Rubin.
Yep.
So what does that all boil down to? This actually is a 3-drop. And yes. For that 3 mana, you get a 4/4 body. You get immediate interaction with graveyards as far as creatures are concerned, whether that happens to be them building up their graveyard for Rally the Ancestors, or them having any kind of like death trigger or Deathmiss Raptor, that you kill a Deathmiss Raptor or Hangerback Walker, and you've actually killed it.
Yes.
Right? They don't get the upside on those cards anymore.
One of the big upsides to Anafenza, and a reason I think it deserves to be a level or two higher than Kalidus, is that it is, again, it's a collected company hit. Mm-hmm. So it's really important in the rally mirrors. And then it also serves like as a kind of second purpose, that they can bring it in when they want to be a little bit more aggressive. When the opponent has so much graveyard hate that the rally plan isn't consistent, they can board in Anafenzas, and then their collected companies, the strength of them, just becomes so much higher for as far as like individual power level wise. But yeah, very important card in the rally mirror.
No, so you make a great point that in some matchups, there's, you know, historically, combo decks have boarded in a 3-mana 5/5, like Phyrexian Negator with a huge drawback. Ugh. Here you get, I mean, obviously times have changed, but even having said that times have changed, here you get to bring in a card with a bunch of text that's beneficial to you, that happens to be a great aggressive card. It's good at attacking, it's good at blocking, it pumps other creatures. As it's making Den Protector, for example, bigger, Den Protector gets harder to block. Like, all these little things it does that are upside, with a clock you can board in and make your deck more aggressive.
Well, and the clock is so important. I mean, if you remember Birthing Pod in Modern, and you would play against maybe, say, Jund, and the draws that actually gave you a lot of trouble were the ones where they had Tarmogoyf and Disruption. When they didn't have Tarmogoyf, it actually wasn't that big of a deal if they had Disruption, because there weren't many ways to clock you.
Yeah.
And the Tarmogoyf plus, say, a Pithing Needle or whatever, that was usually your downfall. You know, it was normally a good matchup, except when they had that kind of like big body plus Disruption. And Anafenza fuses the two together for that kind of a matchup.
Oh, yeah. If I'm a rally player I didn't draw my way to kill Anafenza, but it's okay, I've got some time. Well, how much time do you really have?
And what are you doing with that time?
Because, this card isn't, what's it called, Nevermore? What's the card that's white, one, like Metally Mage a card?
Yeah, Metally Mage is a card, yep.
When you spend your turn doing something like that, a lot of times, or Infinite Obliteration, I mean, as long as I'm in charge, a card like Infinite Obliteration is not going to get within 10 feet of the list like this, because that's a card that where you spend 3 mana, you don't impact the board.
Yep.
You know, you kind of like cross your fingers.
It may not even be a 1-for-1.
You cross your fingers and hope for a 1-for-1. Exactly right. Anafenza is the antithesis of that in terms of how to sideboard and how to think about efficient sideboard cards.
And the aggro plan is definitely big as well. We mentioned that a little bit. This is a different sideboard card, a little bit more obscure, but Adam Boyd actually brought in not just Anafenza, but Pitiless Horde Against Me. The 3-mana.
It's a 5/3 with dash. Right?
Yeah, it's a 5/3 with dash. It's got two of the Juzam Jinn drawbacks.
Yeah.
It's from that lineage. Right. It's from that lineage of creature.
So if you're looking for other sideboard cards out of rally, if you like the idea of going aggressive, that's another one that you might tinker around with. Anyway, very scary card. Very good at killing Chandra. So
yeah.
So if you expect more of like the ramp deck that's playing Chandra, it might be something to consider.
And the way the games play out in this standard, a lot of times this card does get Reflector Mage back to your hand. Because it only costs 3 mana, you can deploy it 2 turns later and not feel too bad about the exchange.
Yeah, because maybe you can play something else.
This card is not Tassigar. Tassigar's a card that, like, good luck with that.
That card got chased out of the format real fast.
Well, because you have to, you know, when you're putting a creature on the board in this format, you have to think about what's going to happen when this gets Reflector Mage.
Yeah, upon reflection, I'm not going to play this card
both
anymore.
Bant and Rally are going to look to do that all the time. But this is just not that card, because it has an immediate impact that when they bounce it, it's not that expensive to deploy, and you don't have to unmorph it to get the benefit. It just kind of is what it is, and it's not that expensive.
Well, that's our number 4 card on the list. At number 3, we're getting into some counter spells now. We've got Disdainful Stroke. This card is just one of the great success stories of design for me. I mean, we've seen it a little bit maybe with like Spell Snare. It evokes that. But Spell Snare is one mana, and I mean, two is such a popular cost. It's easy to see why that would succeed. I think if you look at Disdainful Stroke, you know, on the spoiler, I can't imagine that there was a single person who was just like, this card is going to make an impact on Constructed. And I love that it has.
Yeah. You're right. This is a really well designed card. It's a two mana counter spell that's not too good. It's not too bad. It's not mana leak, but because the problem with mana leak is, of course, that you can one for one with it on turn two or on turn six and trade up with it. This is kind of the king of trading up. I love this card. I love this card in Standard. You have to be careful. It's not a creature, so when you're sideboarding it in your collected company decks.
Right.
With any of these cards on this list that aren't creatures, there's a dilutive effect you have to be careful about. So I've been a Bant Coco player for the last couple of months in these Mox tournaments, and that's something I'm mindful of. I can't necessarily afford to bring in four copies of this card, but I really want to.
Right.
Because it stops so many different cards in the format, whether those cards are Rally of the Ancestors, Collected Company, Kalidus above on our list, Dig Through Time, Murderous Cut. Whether they cast it for one or they cast it for four,
it's still a spell you own.
I mean, it's another card in their deck that you might want to counter, that you can counter.
Yep.
It means that this card, when you bring it in, is very rarely stranded in your hand. Mm-hmm. Just a card that I like a lot.
Yeah, and another card that's benefited from the sort of trended Magic of just they're printing cards now where it's kind of like you get what you pay for. So now in Magic, when you pay 4 and 5 mana for something, you're getting 4 and 5 mana worth of a card, and it makes those cards way more playable, and they're way more common. You see them a lot more. Which makes Disdainful Stroke our number three card.
And I'm just to hammer it home even more. You think about a sideboard card. What is it? What is it stopping? Where is the power in my opponent's deck located? A lot of these decks are like 2-3 creatures, and then powerful and Collected Company and Rally the Ancestors, yep. Or Dig Through Time with jankier interactive spells, right? So like. The card I'm bringing in is Disdainful Stroke.
Yeah,
Ojutai is a great example. I'm actually interacting with the overpowered part of my opponent's deck.
Yes.
The part of my opponent's deck that's actually aggressively costed or aggressively designed is Collected Company. It's not the 2-3 creatures. I mean, Reflector Mage is its own story. But it's not like, it's not some of these creatures that they're hitting off of it necessarily, right? That are just like 2-3s and 3-3s. It really is the 4-mana spells in some of these decks. So that's why I've felt comfortable having multiple Disdainful Strokes in my sideboards.
That's our number.
Sperling said everything.
Yep.
It's great. Counters the sweeper and the Dig Through Time that'll put them ahead. It's fantastic.
That's our number three card. Our number two is Transgress the Mind. So why is this card at number two?
Yeah, I mean, Caleb, why don't you talk about this? I mean, it definitely is in a similar design space that Disdainful Stroke is in, but it works a little bit differently.
Yep.
Right. One key thing about Transgress the Mind is that it exiles the permanent that you're hitting. Mm-hmm. And when people are playing Death Mist Raptors, when people are playing Rally the Ancestors to get back their key cards, the exile effect is really strong. And there are people that are taking advantage of the exile effect with cards like Wasteland Strangler, but I'm not really talking about that synergy. I'm talking about Transgress the Mind as purely a sideboard card. And one of the matchups that I really, really, really like Transgress the Mind in is when your opponent is playing Goblin Dark Dwellers, because you have that choice of like hitting one of their very few threats or hitting a key spell, and now they're not going to have access to that key spell later when they go to play their Goblin Dark Dwellers. You've kind of removed that tool from the tool belt permanently.
Right.
So that's really, really good. Against ramp, the fact that Duress can only hit a ramp spell and it can't actually... hit that world breaker that's going to come down on turn five destroy your mana base is a really big difference. That's huge.
Yeah, and Disdainful Stroke is not going to stop the Stonewind effect of world breaker.
Yep.
So
or of Ulamog. Yeah.
Yeah, and then also to call back to our discussion of Duress, you get to spend the mana when you're ready. I mean, with this card, you kind of have to do it. Well, I wouldn't say you have to do it sooner rather than later. If you're playing as ramp, you can certainly wait.
Yeah.
But the point is that while you're developing your mana base, while you're still thinking about the more expensive cards in your hand, like Siege Rhino, let's say, or whatever, Goblin Dark Dwellers, you get to just like deploy this. And you don't have to make a tough choice between playing your Siege Rhino and leaving up Disdainful Stroke.
Right.
So I think if you're talking about why is this at number two versus number three, I think those kind of considerations are what are the reasons why you might gravitate towards this one.
Yep.
You can tap out for it. I've seen people hit this card off of Abbot of Carol Keep, where if you hit a disdainful stroke, you just whiffed. But if you hit this card, you've interacted.
Yep.
So, you know, just it has a proactive nature to it.
Yeah, and it's just, it's very hard to lose when you're playing these cards. You can miss, but it's, you know, part of what makes it a good sideboard card is you know that the cards that you care about are the cards that can hit. So if you miss with it, then you're probably in great shape because they don't have the cards that you're scared of in their hand. And you don't face the, like, problematic prospect of shipping with two mana up and then they waste your mana somehow. Like, you leave up Disdainful Stroke and they play a three drop.
Yeah.
Or whatever.
One of the ways to whiff that is painful is if they have Rally the Ancestor. I don't think it's a very good card against them. It's okay. I mean, I think it's playable, but I don't know. Caleb, what do you think about the card? If it's in your sideboard, you play against Rally, do you even bring it in?
I think you want a few. I think you want a few for sure.
Okay.
A nice split with Duress is fine as well, like in that matchup, because a lot of the times the sideboard cards that Rally has access to, the ways of that they have of protecting and disrupting, a lot of those are actually going to be spell based. So they're going to be bringing in cards like Murderous Cut and whatnot, and they might be shaving some Rallies. So like a split with Transgress and Duress is pretty nice. One reason that I think Transgress should be higher on the list than Duress is, again, because of the actual XL effect that makes it a little bit uniquely purposed in this format.
Yeah.
When it exiles something, it tends to, and that's relevant, it tends to be really relevant, like game winning. So
Jace.
Yeah, I mean, Worldbreaker and Deathmist Raptor bring themselves back, mm-hmm. and are kind of big thorns in the side of control decks. So, yep. Absolutely right. Like, you know, when the exile clause matters, you can knock out an entire game plan. In the case of Worldbreaker, if you exile their Worldbreaker, I mean, that's an entire game plan that you've knocked out because of that one word, you know, that one clause on there.
I mean, there are situations where you would rather have this in Thoughtseize, and that speaks a lot to its power. That's our number two card. At number one, we've got the best sideboard card in Standard, Dispel. Simple, clean, does the job. This is a great card.
It's so cheap that the drawback of having to leave mana up for it
is really
mitigated a lot. You're not telegraphing what you have because you happen to just have one or two lands dangling. It's not like, it's just easy to keep up, and there's a cat and mouse with trying to, like, let's say you want a Disdainful Stroke Collected Company. Mm-hmm. Are you going to leave up two mana on your turn, say go, they say go, you leave up mana, then they cast the Krasis that you can't counter, right?
Yep.
With Dispel, though, if they're willing to spend their turn passing, I'm happy to leave that mana up and do something with the rest of my mana.
Yep.
It's just so much easier to do two things in a turn when one of those things costs one mana.
Yep. And, yeah, go ahead, Caleb.
Oh, one thing that I really like about Dispel is that it's good against Rally and it's good in Rally. Mm-hmm. And I think that because Rally is like the focal point of the format, I think that's a really good reason to push it up towards the number one. It hits both of the key cards, and then it also helps forces through those same cards, and it even protects the beatdown plan against the piles of removal spells that are also good against Rally because it's a creature-based combo deck.
Yeah, for sure. I know that there's some cards that we mentioned Infinite Obliteration. I think some of the cards that aren't on this list are here because we thought they were main deckable cards. Caleb, do you want to talk about Hallowed Moonlight and how
we can talk about Hallowed Moonlight?
I know we suggested this one and Caleb was like, wait a second.
Yeah.
This is not a sideboard card at all.
I think most decks that you would want to sideboard Hallowed Moonlight in, you would probably either be playing like a Dispel or something of that nature, or you should be main decking Hallowed Moonlight at this point. Reed Duke played in a recent Mox was playing Hallowed Moonlight in the main deck of his Esper deck. I recently requalified for the Pro Tour with Hallowed Moonlights in the main deck of Mardu Green. The thing that makes Hallowed Moonlight such a great main deck card is that it's actually not very dead in the matchups that aren't Rally. It's not like this unique hoser because it cycles, and then there's also tons of other ways that people are spitting tokens into play and cheating creatures into play besides Collected Company. Collected Company, by the way, which is part of multiple top-tier decks, not just Rally, it's also in Bant, which is also playing Deathmist Raptor, and so, like, stopping Deathmist Raptor triggers when your opponent isn't expecting
it.
Another game-winning play. Collected Company, meanwhile, is a card that they want to play on your end of turn, And so even if you tap out for a Siege Rhino or whatever, they untap, they draw their collected company. There's a lot of people that won't fire it off as a sorcery.
Especially
because they
game
don't want
one.
To run into your sweeper. They don't want to make it easier for you to sequence your removal spells. So they'll wait till your end of turn, or they'll wait until you're actually attacking with Siege Rhino to try and get you mid-combat. And so that makes Moonlight a very difficult card for decks to play around out of the main deck. And then there's all these other synergies. It stops Secure the Wastes. It stops Hangerback Walker. It stops P&K from being a reasonable magic card at all. Even the aggressive red decks are playing 3-mana spit 3/1/1s into play. There's not actually very many matchups where it's a pure dead card, and when it is, you can cycle it for 2-mana.
Yeah.
Bam, no problem.
And we should clarify there that while many of these cards see play in the main deck, Caleb's point is that Hallowed Moonlight is actually better as a main deck card than it is as a sideboard card, and that's why we didn't put it on the list.
Yeah, we need to get a chance to talk about it, and you know, that's a really interesting take on it, and I think there's, you know, that's not surprising to me that figuring that out a few weeks before the rest of the world figures that out helps people qualify for the Pro Tour like you did. I mean, that's part of being active in Magic and testing and tuning is like recognizing, oh, this is
watching Magic TV.
Watching Magic TV. There's a sideboard card that I keep sideboarding in. There's a sideboard card that seems good against so many different decks, and it's not that dead. It's a cantrip. What if I tried this main deck? Maybe I can solve a couple hard problems for the main deck. So I mean, hats off. I kind of, you know, that's good thing. That's good Magic.
And it's uniquely better than a lot of the permanent based hosers like Anafenza and Kalidus, because again, like we mentioned, everybody's playing Force of DC's Faithful, not a reliable hoser unless you can pair it with removal spells that turn. It can be difficult. Sometimes the opponent has time to set up and build around Anafenza just because they have so many creatures in play.
Yeah, and also it's important that your best chance to get them with Hallowed Moonlight, if they are Rally, is game one, because they don't have their dispels.
Right.
They're not expecting you to have interaction points. Like Caleb mentioned, they might try to do something on your turn that in a game two they would do during their main phase, and then it really only has to work once to really get them.
Yep.
Like to really swing a game, you know, if you're drawing a card and countering their spell that costs 4 mana, or you're literally just like exiling the creature because they rallied. I mean, that's just so huge that it's really smart. And I wish I had thought of it, right? Because I've been playing standard, and if I had, you know, those game ones, it's so much easier to get the value out of the card.
Yeah. Well, we'll be interested.
Going back to Dispel for one quick second.
Sure, yeah.
One of the reasons I think that Dispel should rightfully rank higher than a card like Duress is because of the sheer chance of bricking with Duress, as opposed, like bricking with Duress gives you a lot of great information, and that's awesome, but Dispel will counter their collected company or their rally off the top of their deck, and there's definitely those moments in the standard format where you're both just sitting there playing draw go because neither of you have any creatures in play, and whoever draws the first awesome bomb is going to win. If you draw a Duress and it bricks, I mean, that might do nothing, whereas like holding on to a Dispel could be very easily be game-winning when your opponent rips that rally off the top.
Protecting yourself from Thoughtseize Tilt is one of the most underrated factors in Magic, I'd say. You know, when you Thoughtseize them, you see that the coast is clear, you're like, all right, I got this, and then the next turn they play the card.
Yeah.
And every time you just
how many stories that start out with I duress or Thoughtseize? Here's what I saw, and then two turns later, guess what happened to me?
God, I can't believe it. Yeah, just every time.
But if you just had a dispel out,
no such concerns, and that's important. All right. Well, we'll be interested to see how it all shakes out at GP Houston. If you can make it down to GP Houston, that's a Channel Fireball Run event. I'll be there. Come by and say hi, and be happy to talk about the show. Otherwise, we'll see you next week. Thanks for tuning in.